Margaret, to Anna Officer Lehen Shah, Umhan Anna, son Anad Alling Shah, and Alva Maxima, the Lauren Holzschule, a Gurkey. Ladies and gentlemen, friends, welcome. Thank you for that very generous introduction, Lawrence. Your symbols matter, anniversaries matter, celebrations matter. Celebrations can be used to include or to exclude. And this is an inclusive celebration. You would have seen the flag, the rainbow flag, on your way in. You would have seen it also over our City Hall many days. We're proud of the Lord Mayor, his commitment, the commitment of the staff, the commitment of the chief executive of the city to promote diversity and LGBT matters. You know, UCC is the first third-level institution in the country to permanently fly the rainbow flag. We have it out in College Road on the Student Union building, and we're delighted to have the officers of the Student Union here with us this evening. Everybody present today, staff, students, visitors, are witnessing an official public affirmation of the university's commitment to the LGBT community, whether it's here on the main campus or in Tyndall or any other branch of the university. So the flags are flying. We are celebrating the 10th anniversary of the founding of the LGBT staff network here in the Alma Maxima. And it is very significant that we're doing it here. This is the great hall of the university, the single most important space, the heart of the university. I'm still getting feedback. I'm just going to try and turn this down. Is that better? Is that down? No. Yeah, I'll just try and stand back a little bit here. And, you know, I'm reminded of the speeches that were given here on November 7th, 1849, the opening day of this university. Because this university was founded on a very important principle at that time of being non-discriminatory and inclusive in regard to religion. That was a very novel concept in 1849, the idea that we would welcome the children of all religions or none into a university was a very controversial topic. Cork was known to be a city of inclusion, that Frederick Douglass had been here a few years before the university opened, right when the city was planning to found it. And you know, when Frederick Douglass came to Cork, he was a single issue abolitionist supporting emancipation for American slaves. But after he came to Cork, he understood that human rights were much broader than slavery. He saw Irish people here who were discriminated against, women and so forth, and he became the world's first broad-based human rights advocate because of the time he spent here in Cork in October and November of 1845, which was right when the famine was beginning. So he witnessed a tremendous amount here in his period in Cork, and so I was delighted to install a statue of Frederick Douglass, 9 foot tall statue of him at the University of Maryland, which was actually designed in Ireland. It's a copy of that you've seen in my office, and I unveiled a plaque to Frederick Douglass 5-6 years ago in the Imperial Hotel. If you go to the Imperial Hotel, go on into the back and see a plaque celebrating Frederick Douglass because he gave his last speech in Cork in the Imperial Hotel. So. I'm very interested in that topic, but let's get back to the topic of the evening. 10 years ago, my predecessor, Michael Murphy, did what would have been unimaginable, that is, he launched the LGBT staff network here in UCC. You know, I've been away for over 30 years, and Ireland is a vastly different place. America is too, but in the opposite direction. It seems like things have flipped, okay? And you heard Lawrence talking about that. And so I was joking last summer that I would be the first refugee from America. And that wasn't because I was predicting Trump was going to win. It was really because of the way the discourse was going. And then on November 9th, people said, "Oh, you're a genius, how did you know?" But anyway, you know, things have changed dramatically here. I mean, who would have imagined 10 years ago that we would have a teacher who's a graduate of Trinity College Dublin? That would have been unimaginable a generation ago to think about, among other things. And of course, we would be fortunate to have the Taoiseach here tomorrow, all day, and the entire cabinet. you'll be here. Which is pretty amazing. There would be a cabinet meeting here, and this has never happened before in the history of the country that a university has hosted a cabinet meeting. So this is very important for UCC, for the LGBT community, for the city as a whole. And so, you know, Ireland became the first country in the world to introduce marriage equality in the referendum. So, you know, the state's commitment to the implementation of diversity and equality and the common decency and good manners that goes with that has been quite amazing and quite transformational. I mean, when I left over 30 years ago, you know, Ireland was a very discriminatory, very monocultural country. And if you didn't comply with the norm, you know, you just would have tremendous difficulty living, you know, renting an apartment, just doing anything. I mean, it was shocking. But things have changed, and you know, anything less than total inclusion of LGBT people and total equality is you know, unacceptable, and we have to reject as indecent and ignorant any rejection of people from the community. So, you know, many Irish people from many generations were included. This is a historic fact. There, you know, many the display at the back, the books at the back demonstrate that, and also the website, the Celta project, which maps Ireland's LGBT heritage, is based on a project sponsored by the UCC network. And of course, the word Celta means hidden, which reflects the past. And generations of Irish people had to hide. They were shamed into silence, implicitly or explicitly, and threatened with ruin if they were true to themselves. So, you know, they had to live a lie. And so never again. We will never allow the progress of the past decade to be compromised, undermined, and reversed. And we have to be vigilant in this regard, because we're seeing in the United States right now the progress of the past 14 years is being reversed, as you have said. And you can't just sit back and expect that once progress is made that it can't go backwards. So we have to be vigilant, and we have to be advocates for this. So you've heard me say that diversity nurtures the fertile fields from which great ideas grow. So diversity is not just a good idea, it's a necessary idea, because diversity promotes quality. I said that when I was launching the strategic plan recently, because diversity promotes robustness in society. It's critical that you have diverse ideas, you have people who don't necessarily agree on everything, who have different approaches. That is critically important. Monocultures never thrive. Go back to the founding of this university, 1845, the famine. We had a monoculture associated with potatoes. Potatoes failed, people didn't know what to do. Diversity is important in all aspects of our lives. And so, as you've heard, we are committed to equality, diversity, and inclusion in this university. Earlier this year, the registrar and I and our colleagues worked to form the Office of Equality, Diversity and Inclusion, and we will be moving forward with our commitment to that unit as a priority. I am committed to the development of an action plan for staff and students which fully mainstreams equality, and I'm committed to ensuring that the culture and practice of the university supports the prompt implementation of this plan, which will entail, among other things, the collection and analysis of relevant data, because we are an institution of learning and scholarship, so we will have data benchmarking in relation to a national and international best practice. I mentioned symbols at the beginning. We have to ensure that the symbols of the university express our equality, diversity, and inclusion. And we will be mindful of the images we use in all our materials, as you will have seen, so that our audiences internally and externally fully recognize that diversity and inclusion is important to us. So I, as the president, I pledge this university will never tolerate homophobia. I promise that LGBT staff and students will never have to hide here, and that they always will be truly free. And I pledge that we will continue to make this a place of safety, a place of openness, and a place of welcome to the LGBT community internally and externally. And that we will be then a beacon to the wider community, to the city, the county, the province, the country, and the world, because we are now globally connected. These issues are not local, they are completely global. And I'd like to leave you, before I finish, with an amusing but true story that relates to the speech that my predecessor Kane gave on the 7th of November 1849. You know, it was controversial because he was talking about a secular non-denominational university, and so he decided he would try and, you know, get the Catholic Church on board by sending an Italian translation of the speech to the Curia in Rome, so that they would understand what he was talking about the importance of the inclusion. So he asked the professor of Italian at Trinity College, Professor Vassilio Agnelli, to translate his speech into Italian. Now it turns out Professor Agnelli wasn't a very good translator. I think the quality of Trinity was not good in those days. And so, you know, Kane began his speech with the usual greeting, which was "Ladies and gentlemen." And this is a true story, I'm not making this up. So Professor Agnelli translated that as "gentlemen of both sexes." So you can see, we've been very diverse, very from the very beginning here at this institution. So happy birthday, thank you.